abundant life. Now, what greater life would you live than to glorify your Creator? You know, how do I represent Him on earth? How can we, well, let's say we represent God. We're His representative. And that's one of the things in way back in the old days, they said that the king's people were put there to represent Him and be His representatives. And so, you know, we're God's representatives on earth. How do we do that? How do we represent God? Two things I think of is, one, my reverent fear of God, have a right kind of fear of God, understanding who He is, and the other one is obedience. You know, I don't like that word. You know, we hate that word obedience, don't we? But here's the thing. God doesn't want your begrudging submission, you know, that, oh, I got to do this because God said so. He doesn't want that. You know, like when you have to apologize to your sister, and then you have to apologize again and act like you mean it. That's what it's like. You know, God doesn't want your begrudging submission. He wants your loving obedience. Matt Chandler said it this way. In talking about the law, you know, and because when we think of submission and obedience, then we think, well, I've got to keep the law. And I thought you said we didn't have to do that because we're under grace. And, you know, so we get all wrapped up in this keeping the law thing. And when anybody says that, we just don't want to do that. But obedience means keeping the law. Listen, he says, the law is designed to lead you not to begrudging submission, but to lead you to greater life and greater joy, because it lines you up with how God designed things to work. Rather than trying to do it your way, which doesn't work. Marriage, sex, money, rest, all the things that God created, those were His ideas. Did y'all get that? Sex was God's idea. So don't you think if you do it God's way, it'll be better than if you do it the way you want to do it? And if I linger on that, I'll get in trouble, so we'll stop with that. But when you do things the way God intended you to do them, in obedience to Him, that's when they begin to have meaning, and that's when life begins to become abundant. God's law leads to life. Obedience leads to us delighting in Him. He's sovereign. You hear that word thrown around a lot. Sovereign means He's independent of everything. And in Him, everything has its meaning, is based on God. He's sovereign. He's the center of the universe. And think about this. All the problems in your life happen when you try to be center of the universe. Think about that. When you try to be the center of your own little world, that's when you have problems. Who is to blame for most of the problems in your life? Jeff, you raised his hand. Oh, no, I am is the right answer. Who's the cause of all the problems in your life? You are. You know, when you're driving down the highway and somebody is in the left lane, why are you in the left lane? You know, because suddenly it's not about them, it's about you. And who said that was your lane and nobody else could drive it? Or in a relationship. You know, suddenly when it all becomes about you, the relationship begins to fall apart. But when the relationship is about the other person, when what can I do for them, suddenly the relationship blossoms. Think about that. When the world revolves around you, things begin to fall apart. When they revolve around God, they begin to be abundant. God didn't need to create us. He needs nothing from us. Yet what He wants is for us to glorify Him. That's why we were created. That's His purpose. Let me read this to you. If you got your Bibles, flip over to Psalm chapter 8. I don't want to just reference this offhand. Psalm chapter 8, it's kind of in the middle of Psalm chapter 8. Because you'll recognize some of these words from this worship song. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength. because of your foes, to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little more than heavenly beings, that means we're above everything else, and crowned him with glory and honor. That's us that he's talking about. We are crowned with glory and honor. So we were created to glorify God. What else? Why else are we here? Back to Genesis chapter 1, the story continues. It says, after he created male and female, he created them. And God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over it. Does that sound like God was worried about overpopulation? Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. I don't think God was worried about how many Chinese people there are in the world. China's worried about it, but God's not. I mean, think about this. If we were created to glorify God, then the more people there are, the more glory God gets. You ever think of that? I mean, your parents may joke that glad you were born before December 31st. There's another tax deduction back here, you know? No. You were created to glorify God. That's why you're here. And, here's one that some of you may disagree with, Bill. We were created to subdue the earth and have dominion over it. Now, what does that mean? I mean, contrary to what tree huggers would tell you, we are here use the resources of the earth. That's why we're here. The earth is intended for our use. It is not the other way around. And yes, we're supposed to protect it and care for it. But the earth, just like the human body is created with this amazing ability to heal itself, the earth is created with this amazing resilience to cure itself, to treat itself, to maintain itself. We're supposed to worship the Creator, not the creation. Yeah, we need to recycle and not pollute, but we also need to remember that we are the crowning glory of God's creation, not the earth, not a tree, not a whale, not a sea turtle. We are created with God. We are supposed to be over the earth. It's put here for our use. Now, yes, it needs to be done in a proper way, but let's don't get things out of order. Our life has purpose when we realize that we are the crown and glory of God's creation. Our life has purpose when we realize that the priority that we just above heavenly beings, but above everything else. So we were created to glorify God. We were created to have dominion over the earth. What else? Flip over to Genesis chapter 2, a more detailed story of the creation of man. In verse 15 it says, the Lord God took the man, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. That says, we were created for work. And most of you don't want to hear that. And I doubt many of you are going to go home and repeat that to your parents. But you were created to work. Now a lot of people would think that work came as a result of the fall. After Adam and Eve sinned, God threw him out of the garden and said you had to work. In chapter 3, he says that because you listened to the voice of your wife and eat of the tree, which I commanded you not to, in pain you shall eat all the days of the earth of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field by the sweat of your face. All that's saying is all we have that Adam to thank for, not work, but sweat and weeds. You know, that's weeds or Adam. I blame Adam more for weeds than I do sin. father's fault. So it's not work that was the problem, because he was put in the garden to care for it. Not only was he a gardener, but he's a guardian. He was put in the Garden of Eden to watch over it. That was, and so what that is, productive work then gives life purpose. When we do something productive, we have meaning in life. You know, I know a lot of times people say, I just want to hang out with my friend. I don't want to do anything. I just want to hang out. I mean, yeah, there's a lot to be said for relationship, and we'll touch on that. There's a lot to be said for all that stuff. But our life has purpose and meaning when we do things that are productive. I know none of this is going to get home, is it? You don't hear the productive work part. But trust me, it gives life meaning. And one thing Brett's working on is they're filming all these Wednesday nights, because Brett wants to start kind of an inventory of the Wednesday night services. He's spending time to do that. He's editing it, puts it in, because it gives him fulfillment to do that. It's something he wants to do. You know, I was in, and Mark will appreciate this, when I was in college, one of the summer jobs I did was I worked for my uncle building houses. And it was the most, you know, it was hard work, but it was the most fulfilling job, really, that I ever had. Because, you know, you go there with nothing but a blank slate. And when you leave at the end of the day, there's a house there. You know, there's purpose and fulfillment in that. You're seeing a project completed, something like that that you can see. I did that. Life has purpose. And it may not mean anything to you now, but if you stop and think about that, stop and think about it, and you'll accomplish something. That's part of the abundant life Jesus is talking about. Because that's what we were created to do. When we do the things that God created us to do, we begin to enjoy the abundant life that we have. So we were created to glorify God. We were created to have dominion over the earth. We were created to work. What else? One more. Genesis 2, verse 18. The Lord said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make a helper fit for him. We were created for what? Relationships. God made us for relationships. Now what goes on here is he establishes marriage as the best of all, the ultimate of all relationships. And let me stop there and maybe point out a couple of things about marriage for those of you that are thinking way too far ahead. Verse 22 says, and the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. We can learn a lot from that one short little phrase. And brought her to the man. That means God will provide your spouse. You don't need an E-trade or E-date or E-whatever it is. I guess E-trade wouldn't work with it. Okay, right. I need a little white swap.